Hello, everybody. I'm Alexis Brink, and I'm the president of Junction Institute, and I'm a member of the Social Action Committee for the USA TEAA. And today I'm here with Ruth Pagano, and Ruth is the granddaughter of Mary Golding. And hi, Ruth.
Hello.
And Claudia O'Reilly, who's Mary's daughter. And what an honor to have you. And let's hear a little bit about Mary. So Ruth, let me start with you. What was your relationship like with your grandmother? Did you see her often?
Yes, and thank you. It's our honor to be here to talk about Mary. So my grandmother was a fixture in my life from day one. She, although when I was very young in the 80s, she was working still. So I didn't see her as much as I would have liked, but every holiday we were together and she always made a point of really celebrating as a family. So some of my earliest memories as a child are of Christmas time and birthdays when, you know, she would have literally the entire family and host these very large events and bring us all together to celebrate as one. And so those are my earliest memories, more from a child's perspective. And then as I got older, she became more of a peer and a mentor to me in terms of, you know, her life's work. And so I think it evolved and definitely became more adult, my relationship with her. But she was always there and she was always very much of a comfort to me and what a grandmother should be.
That's wonderful. And where did you grow up?
Well, I was born in Santa Cruz, California. And but we lived throughout the Monterey Bay area. And my grandmother spent, as a child, my grandmother mostly spent time in Watsonville, California and San Francisco. And so we were always close. We were never, you know, more than a couple hundred miles away from each other. But most often we were very, very close, living within a half an hour or so.
Sounds like she was a real family woman then.
Yes, which is so interesting because she was this larger than life persona in TA. And, you know, to me, she was my grandmother. She was Grandma Mary. And so it just, it was nice to see her as a real life human, you know, and not necessarily a celebrity. At least I didn't know at the time when I was a child.
Yes, well, she has contributed to so much to the TA community. And so it's nice to hear from you that she was a family person and really that you have warm feelings for her. Claudia, you told me that you traveled with your mom. What were the key things that you learned from her about the world?
Yes, we traveled a lot. My mother was fiercely independent as a youth and left home in the suburbs of Chicago for Mexico City when she was 18 and went to work as a telephone operator. And fell in love with Mexico, which lasted her whole life. She was fluent in Spanish and had friends in Mexico and Cuba. And we spent a lot of our vacations down there. Later on in the 90s and 2000 on, when she wasn't working anymore at the Institute. Okay, so the Institute, Western Institute for Group and Family Therapy, started in 1970, and that was in Watsonville. So it was a little bit odd, Ruth's memories of childhood. She was the matriarch of our family, but also ran an institute. So often in the 70s would be before Ruth was born, but early in the 80s also, there would be 20, 30 people at her house also staying for conferences. So that was kind of her last home. And after Bob Goulding died, her second husband, she wanted to go live in San Francisco. And she loved the city. And she was courageous. I'll tell you a little story from San Francisco. Once we were coming home from a play, Mary and I, and it was late at night, and I thought we were lost. And we were in a district where there were a lot of night people out and homeless people. And I was terrified. And my mother was never afraid. In fact, some of the homeless people in San Francisco knew her by name, which I never asked why. Why do they know your name, mother? But I presume that she gave them money and food and talked to them just like normal people. But so that was her San Francisco days. And I loved Europe and art. And my mother shared that love of Europe, although my mother went everywhere. Some of the pictures I sent you, she went on safari in Africa. She wanted to go places where that were unspoiled, that were still
natural,
mm-hmm. or the people were indigenous. Mm-hmm. So she went places like Irian Jaya as soon as it was open to the public, and there were still people who had wars with bows and arrows. She went to Cambodia before the war was really over and the Khmer Rouge bombed the hotel she was at. I mean, she just—
Fearless.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And she was very adventurous, and she had a couple of adventurous sisters. So they started the travel thing. We caught the travel bug. I was more into Paris than roughing it in Africa.
So did she travel to, you think, to learn? And did she bring back what she learned to her work?
She traveled because she had always wanted to be an anthropologist. That was her first love. Before she became a professional therapist. And yes, she loved learning about different cultures. She loved Vietnam, and she loved kind of giving back. So she wanted to go places where she could work for free. They wanted her or needed her and would just pay her expenses. And she would go to countries that didn't have ITAA yet, or transactional analysis. And she worked in Japan a lot back in the 60s and 70s, and actually, you know, lived in palaces and, you know, just a very charming, you know, relationships with princesses and figures of lore, you know.
So it sounds like she really went all over the world, and being in different cultures, that was comfortable for her. And that leads me into really Project TA101, which the course videos are dedicated to the memory and spirits of Mary and Bob Golding. And they've guided this project really from the beginning, and also linking it from the past to the present and the future generations of TA. And it seems like her travels and always being with different cultures, that she really inspired social justice, and that it was very important to her. What do you feel about the social justice part, Claudia?
Oh, yes. Social justice was very important to her. I became aware of that 1960, the election of John Kennedy, was when my parents and some other parents of friends all gathered during election time. And then around that same time, living on the West Coast, she became very involved with Cesar Chavez's causes. during the 60s, the great growers and farm workers' rights, and that was very important to her.
Yes, I guess all her travels really culminated into this movement of social justice. And so it's really nice that this project is dedicated to her. Mm-hmm. And it must make you feel really good as well, Ruth.
It does.
Yes, because I guess you saw that side of her too then, of her, the importance of social justice.
Yes, she taught me about equal rights, equal opportunities, equal treatment. And I can still remember going on, adding on to what my mother said in San Francisco, is that we would go out and eat in restaurants, and she would always, whatever food we didn't finish, she would pack it up. And then we would walk around, and whoever we saw, unsheltered or, you know, impoverished, poor, they could have been, drug addicted. She would provide whatever we had. She would give the coat that she was wearing to them. She had a big heart for, especially for people who were less fortunate than she was. And that is why she went to those countries, because she knew that she would have a big impact, because it was genuine. It was a genuine care from her to try to help people to get better in their relationships and their lives. And the social justice, I mean, you know, she was always, you can do whatever you want, Ruth. It doesn't matter who you are, what your gender is, and the same for her children.
Yeah, wonderful. Did she, when she traveled, did she give conferences?
Yes. The first time I went to Europe in 1974 was sort of the first time I realized that she, you know, was famous, or, you know, that all these people knew my mother. Mm-hmm. I went kind of on her, piggybacked her way over to Europe, and was at a conference in Switzerland, and I walked into a big auditorium, and everybody was standing doing this applauding, and I didn't know what it was for. Then I saw my mother walk on the stage, and I thought, oh my God, how did all these people know my mother, you know?
Ruth, what was her contribution? What was Mary's contribution to TA? Can you describe?
To help improve relationships from every level. Right. And I think that was what she was born to do. And I think I can just remember her and watching her in front of people, always talking about, you know, parent child. And I wasn't a student, but I can remember these things and her trying, you know, especially at Wigfoot in Watsonville. That was where she held more intimate, the 20 to 30 people kind of really intense therapy. I think that was she was really trying to help them to have a better life, because whatever led them there, whatever happened in their childhood or whatever happened in their adult relationships was unresolved. So she was really, that was her goal, I think. And at least that's what she imparted to me, but I was never a student of hers. So.
And in the 70s, our government, a lot of the people that came to Wigfoot to learn TA and to study and, you know, help in their personal lives also, they came from police departments. Our government paid for this and supported it. Mental health, police departments and juvenile detention centers and people that worked with other people. And so there was funding for this and support. And, you know, it just seems like, you know, of course, the mental health field that has been cut so much, so drastically from funds.
Well, it's pretty nice. It's nice to hear also that she professionally did that, but that she also personally really lived her life like that, and that family is so important.
Yes.
I mean, you clearly all loved her very much and love her very much. So that's really wonderful. And Ruth, I wanted to ask you about your work and how she has influenced you in your professional life.
Well, it's interesting. I did not know that she wanted to be an anthropologist, but I graduated from UCSC in anthropology. And so that's a very interesting thing to me that you just told me that, Mom. So I'm glad I learned that today. And so I started off with really wanting to learn more about other cultures and wanting to experience the world. And then I fell in love with true crime. So I became an investigator, but I was more of a social advocate during all of my investigation. So I spent over a decade doing scene investigation work at a police department. But the victim advocacy part was really my motivation in trying to help, people who had lost everything. All I worked were major crimes. And so it's interesting because my grandmother, she knew what I did. She lived long enough to see it. She always warned me that, you know, working in law enforcement as a female, especially, is very challenging. And, you know, there are a lot of hurdles and a lot of barriers, but she encouraged me to do so. And I think that work, although it was extremely fulfilling, I think it led me to where I am today, which is, you know, trying to do more social work, direct social work. And I work, you know, at a local school district and I support students that have really serious high needs, whether it be homelessness or unsheltered or extremely poor, or also social emotional struggles from trauma. So I'm not a social worker yet, but I'm going to probably follow those footsteps also. And obviously the anthropology will always be within me.
Yeah, it sounds like in a way you are very similar and have similar interests and even moving forward with the same thing, what you described in her history, it sounds very similar. So that's really great to hear.
And it's very interesting, especially because my adult life, at least for the last 12 years, I haven't had her. So, you know, yeah, I think she has lived on. And I don't know if my mom feels that way, but maybe there is a part of grandmother in me, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Claudia, yes? You feel
yes.
That?
You see? Oh, yes. Ruth has her grandmother's eyes. Oh. Except the color is darker, but the shape, yes.
Yeah.
Yes. See. Oh, I think a lot about my mother and the things that she would like to see now that she missed. You know, she died 2 weeks before her first great-grandchild, Ruth's oldest daughter, was born. And, but I also think of how angry and upset and how horrible she would be these last 4 years with Trump in office. So she at least saw Barack Obama coming into office, was very happy about whatever social progress we had made. And at that point.
So important. And you mentioned Ruth's daughters. She has two daughters and Mary's great-granddaughter. So I guess they just didn't meet, but Ruth, you had a little story about that.
Yeah,
in your belly.
Yeah, she knew. I'll try not to get too emotional, but when my mother was with her when she was dying, and I was too pregnant to drive to a hospital, especially in Oakland, that was going to be too much of a trek for me, and I wasn't under the impression that she wasn't dying. I just was on the phone with her and I had to say goodbye. And it was very hard in the sense of, I wish that I could have been there, but I know she knew why I couldn't be. And that was because I was pregnant with Kayla, and she knew who she was. She knew her name. And the whole time I was saying goodbye to her on the phone, I was holding my belly and Kayla was kicking. And, you know, it was very emotional, but I know that she knew that I was there with her, just not, you know, in the room.
Yes.
Yeah. And then I gave birth. And so it was, you know, this beautiful end of life, start of life cycle.
Yeah. And Inger also, who was a close friend of her, of Mary's, mentioned that she, because your birthday is when?
At the beginning of December, December 5th, right? And she waited until after.
Well, how touching is that? So that's really a beautiful story.
Yeah, and Inger is such a beautiful human being. We are so lucky to have Inger in our lives. I think she, you know, she has always meant a lot to my mom and I and our family. But after my grandmother passed, she hasn't wavered. She's still part of our family. So
yeah, that's why I had a chat with her also.
Yes. She's the source of grandma for me.
Yes, wonderful. Well, she's around and active. And
and Mary lived with Inger the last year of her life. Inger and Reiko True and Felipe were very frequent travelers with us.
Okay, so it brings the whole community.
Yes. Well, Mary lived in San Francisco, the rents were high, nothing like they are now. But she lived in an apartment. They wouldn't let her sublet it. And her idea was to live sometimes in San Francisco and live at other people's houses all over the world in exchange. So she gave up her apartment because she couldn't afford to travel and keep this apartment. When she traveled really a lot, she lived more in hotels than she did in a house. And so she would just say, oh, I'm going to be in such and such a place. All you have to do is fly out there and you can join me. So we had a lot of trips where we'd meet her halfway through her trip in Europe, and some family members would be leaving, others would be coming. We went to England. We have a lot of wonderful memories. And sometimes because she was working in these other countries, we'd have some local people showing us around, being tour guides. And my mom was great at finding some good adventurous things. Often came out of the San Francisco Chronicle, but we would stay in old palaces, old, you know, really hundreds of years old places that were being restored and used as bed and breakfast. And just, we really had some fun times.
It sounds very adventurous. Mm-hmm. And I'm so glad that you are sharing all of this. I have one last question. Claudia and Ruth, both of you, and you can take turn, one word to describe Mary Goulding.
Oh God. Well, I have a little bit of a list of one word.
No, you have to pick one word.
One word.
I'll go first. I pick passionate about her work and about her life and about her family.
Passionate. Okay. And I'll pick generous.
Very
good. She was very generous with all of us. We didn't lack experiences. I mean, she would buy tickets to Broadway plays for my children when they were five, you know, and they would sleep through it. But, you know, she.
Right. She generous and passionate. That's beautiful. So let's leave it with that thought for Mary Goulding. And thank you both of you so much. This was very, very special for everybody to hear about Mary. Thank you.
Thank
well,
you.
Welcome, and it's nice to meet you. And
thank you for keeping her memory alive.